Of cycle number nine here for Haunt Tour season number two. We are down to, well, we were down to six teams at the beginning of today. Now we're actually down to five teams as one of the matches, the State Green versus Denali Esports match, actually, as we talked about earlier, got rescheduled to earlier today. That was already played. State Green actually taking out Denali Esports 2-0 in the losers bracket. So knocking them out and State Green staying alive. The winner will actually play State Green in the next round of this match here. With that said, we got Team NK, formerly known as Too Much Sugar, different roster though. Team NK going to be going up against Reason Gaming here in a best out of three to see advances on. With that said, of course, I'm Breaking CBK. Today, my co-caster going to be once again, actually, he's joined me last weekend, going to be joined by Diglett of We Are Spies. Diglett, how's it going?
It's going good, Breaky.
Going pretty good. You, I saw that you were around, and you know, you're not playing. We talked about the last week, and unfortunately, things. Maybe not going the best for the playing side of things, but hey, at least you're open to cast, and that's a good thing.
Yep, I'm always available for Han. Always nice to see good games, and cast is even better.
That's what matters in the end. So I know. Looking forward to, though, a great day. Obviously, we got this match here that actually following, we're going to be covering, of course, the winter bracket finals of Lion Esports Club taking on Team Excellent. And there's a lot to talk about in that one, a lot to get to in that one. But obviously, that's a later series, so let's focus on this one. As I'm rambling on, though, we already have several picks coming out, in fact, between these two sides. So once again, though, Team NK, this team formed going into number Cycle 9 with Internet Gangsters breaking up. Obviously, look at this roster. You got Tankafet, Insania, Panny, Haxorin, and Zibe. Now, Panny, I believe, is more of their sixth man. I believe Onmi is actually their technically their fifth man, but he, once again, is not here today, so Panny in place. But this is definitely a strong roster. However, they were knocked down here by, I believe it was actually Team Excellent, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, Team Excellent took them out 2-0. So anyways, Diglett, we already moved along here. We have Parasite, Ophelia, Wretched Act, Pestilence as far as the bans. It was then Warbeast into Keeper, Tempest into Engineer, and Bubbles into Pebbles, actually, going to be coming out here. So, once again, a lot of consistency coming out between these two teams, not really going too far of reaches here.
Yeah, everything sounds pretty pretty consistent with what's been happening in the past. Pesty is a really, really strong pickup, people have realized, so he's more of the go-to strength hero. That you're starting to see nowadays. Mm-hmm. So I'm not surprised that he's banned. And same with all of the other picks. All the junglers, all the strong supports being picked up. So,
yeah. So we see that here coming out as far as the next tier of bans. And again, you know, we talked about a lot about this obviously last weekend. Now, here we are the following weekend. This is the first major event since the big patch hit. So we're kind of waiting to see what kind of different picks we're going to. I mean, we did see quite a bit. We saw some good ones last weekend, so that was good to see. I'm sure this weekend it'll be somewhat similar. There are certain heroes I know. Cersei has kind of been a hot topic as a result of last weekend and going into this one. Cersei has that support option. No doubt a very popular one, so we'll see if she actually pops up here. But the ban's going to be finishing off. It looks like I need Moon Queen, Ravener, Corrupted, Master of Arms, Kraken. Now, the final ban's actually going to be Sandray, so somewhat carry-heavy bans coming out here. Team NK now. I mean, they got a lot of push to work with. Is there something? I guess they need a support still. You could see them going Cersei, perhaps?
It's possible. People have definitely been trying out that hero. I believe No Shit even ran it as a suicide.
Yeah.
The one game. So people are starting to experiment with heroes, and more so in the competitive scene, because it's different than like just regular TMM. So I saw Hax was trying Solomon the other day as well. Mm-hmm. So people are experimenting with the heroes and seeing where they fit in as far as the meta goes. And I think it's interesting to see, but again, as you said last time, a lot of people are sticking to what they know.
Yeah.
So.
Now, Demented Shaman, that is a little bit different. I mean, it's more of that niche pick, but Demented Shaman going to be coming out here for Team NK. Do you think that could possibly be support Demented, or is it going to be more of maybe a short lane, or what?
Most often you see it as a short lane, because she can get the farm that you kind of need to become a semi-carry, and she can get pretty tanky, and with levels, it's really nice to have the max Entangle plus the max Healing Wave. So that you can stay alive, but still have the stun. So most commonly it's a short lane, but who knows?
We'll see. I mean, I mind something maybe like the Balfagor, you know, the Zephyr even. This is somewhat of a pushed-out lineup already. Well, I was kind of getting it with the Warbeast, the Tempest, so I kind of wonder if they are... Yep, they are going to be calling the Zephyr pickup here. So they get the DS4 more of that support option in the end to go along with the likes of Zephyr. So it's going to be all about the push here and the early game aggression coming out from Team NK. Recent Gaming, they had an interesting pick right there, Forsaken Archer. Actually coming out. Forsaken, not too much of a go-to carry option nowadays, but coming out here for Reason, maybe a little bit of counter push, you think, of results?
Yeah, I think it's a bit of a strange pickup because she doesn't have that much counter push. She does have a decent amount of push with her skeletons. They do a lot of damage to towers, but it seems odd because early game she's rather weak as a ranged hero, and just as far as mobility, she doesn't really have any. So... it's going to be interesting to see that.
And then Pharaoh, the final pick. It's always fun seeing Pharaoh. Again, another kind of hero, though, we haven't seen in a while, it feels like. It really does. I mean, this, you think of Pharaoh as kind of a staple hero, but it honestly, I don't know. We really haven't seen him played a whole lot, if any, as of recently. But going to be picked up here for Reason Gaming. Looks like possibly in the hands of Zane is what it's going to come down to. So we are ready to go into game number one here. Of course, this best set of three, but yeah, so the Forsaken Archer is one thing. The Pharaoh, the final pick, I mean, again, kind of like I get into, not a hero we see too often. I guess it is a counter to Tempest, and, you know, want to be able to a little bit of counter push as well with the spamming of the Tormented Soul, of course. I mean, any more insight on the Pharaoh, and you like the pick?
I like Pharaoh as a hero, but I think for this meta, he's a little bit passive, and people have realized that, because whereas heroes like... Grinnix or Lodestone or Kraken or Scout or anything can set up kills early on. Pharaoh can't really do much until he's level 6. Like, yeah, he has Mummy Walls, and he has Hellfire, and he has the Snipe, but other than that, he can't really do much, so...
Yeah, so that's, yeah, it's going to be interesting to see what Pharaoh is able to do here when it comes down to it. So we do see, obviously, some scouting out coming out right here with a Hellhound, actually, from Warbeast. So he's going to spot, actually, Pebbles kind of running in right there, kind of running on by, but not too much going to be in terms of interaction. Pharaoh, in the meantime, or Forsaken Archer even in the front line, so kind of got confused by this avatar actually for a second, but that is Forsaken Archer. They are going to kind of spot the Legion team right there in Team NK, but not a whole lot of interaction once again going to be coming out between the two, but look at Deathgrowl actually playing the Pebbles right here, trying to see if he can maybe cut somebody off, but it's not going to be happening, and that will be the end of that. But with that said, into the laning phase we go. I want to make a point here, guys. I do know several picks coming out. In fact, as far as audio goes, I'm actually using I have a headset for my mic today and whatnot, so that's probably why I sound a little bit different than usual on the Honcast. So I mean, hopefully it works out. I was testing it before. It sounded like it was good. So I don't see why it wouldn't be. So if I sound different, you know, I apologize if that's awkward for you guys, but it is what it is. So hopefully it's not too big of a deal. Anyways. Moving on here, how about this? They're actually decided to send the Zephyr Demented Shaman into the middle lane instead of that short lane setup to go up against the Pebbles Engineer here. So, what do you think about this here, Diglett?
I think it's safe to send the Zephyr mid. I mean, it's not that great. You know, you see him always as the short lane carry. But if you send him dual lane mid, it kind of... You can't really be that aggressed too heavily, so it kind of guarantees him farm. At least in the middle. So he won't get great farm, but he can't, like, lose all of the farm.
Yeah. Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see how that works out for him. Keeper of the Forest, of course, St. Rock's on the Keeper. He does end up in the jungle right here, and he's going to be doing his jungling thing as he currently has a double stack camp over here with the what was a Catman Champion as well as the Skeleton Kings. But Forsaken Archer, of course, with the short lane, but you see what the Hellhounds are doing from Warbeast right here. How about the double lane pull coming out? That's kind of interesting to see. He's going to pull these all the way through the jungle right here. And going to try to make it a little more difficult on Forsaken Archer. But not too often do we see a double creep wave pull. How do you think that's going to be impacting? The action middle lane, we have a little bit of action. Defensive Shaman puts the Unbreakable up. He's going to be fine for now. Will it be enough for the kill on Pebbles? No, it will not. He does survive, though. No Bloodlust kill coming out for either side. Very close back and forth between Pebbles and Dimension Shaman, though, coming out between the two. But, yeah, how about that double creep wave pull from Warbeast?
It's more so just to, like, mess up FA, because a lot of people Just what they do is they just usually just kill the creep wave by the tower, but then you just keep losing more and more lane control. So pulling two waves kind of messes people up because they don't know how to deal with it. Some people even pull the creeps to the jungle. Like FA would drag it into the jungle and that'd work really well. But then again, you still lose lane control. So it's really hard to manage, and it allows Warbeast to get to manage his own creep waves, and so that he can get a couple levels here and there.
Yeah. All right, so we'll see how he advances there. I kind of awkward there. Anyways. All right, so we'll see when we move on. But again, so this is the only game going on right now. Like I said, the other series obviously already finishing up. State Green took out Denial Esports 2-0. And well, there's actually a little bit more to talk about that concerning Denial Esports, which we'll get into going to the next match. And maybe if we have a little bit more downtime here in this one. But sticking to this game, so you got Bubbles at the bottom lane. He is matched up against Pharaoh here. Let's kind of take a closer look as far as how the creep farm is going and see how things are shaping up there. We got 8-4 Bubbles going up against a 4-0 Pharaoh. So obviously Tankafet here on Bubbles having the better time. And you know, Tankafet, it's kind of interesting also seeing this. Tankafet, not only is he kind of playing a different role now than what we're used to seeing him play as either that main support, even a jungler, but he's also even the captain now of this new Team NK team. So, you know, kind of a completely different style, different responsibilities, but, you know, he actually won, we announced the awards yesterday, he actually ended up winning the Most Improved Player of the Year for the year 2013, and very deservingly so. So in case you missed that, you go to Honkast.com, guys. You can actually check out the article for yourself and all the winners from the 2013 awards. So, but yeah, he's, speaking of him, though, Bubbles outmatching Pharaoh here quite a bit. I'm pretty sure that's expected, right, Diglett?
Yeah, again, Pharaoh's a really passive hero. And all Bubbles really needs to do is just like right click him and auto attack him a lot and throw shells and just be super aggressive. Mm-hmm. And then Pharaoh can't really do much. So.
And again, we see that right here with the Creeper 14-6 now against the 10. I mean, Pharaoh's not managing to do too bad though at the same time. He's definitely getting in some solid creep kills there. So, all right, so as far as the momentum of this game right now, I mean, obviously, you know. You got that key point here for Team NK. It's get set for that early Helm of the Black Legion. You think they're going to be looking to start pushing towers ASAP, or I think they could be comfortable sitting back and playing more of a farm game here?
I don't know. It's hard to say. A lot of teams have been shaking things up. Most people tend to do aggressive stuff, but it could really turn. You know, usually people, if they win one team fight, they'll just like train all of the towers. But if they don't, they'll just kind of play it passive and just see to who makes the first mistake, you know, and just capitalize on that and then just go from there.
Yeah, for the time being, you saw Tempest right there. He was actually trying to be active against Pharaoh, but unfortunately not able to get there in time. And Pharaoh is going to be in safe position to stay alive. So Tempest, by the way, panning here on Tempest, his GPM actually isn't the highest. He does have this one camp blocked right here. I didn't actually notice that right off the bat. I know they at least blocked that one camp. He maybe got a counter on another or not, but he's struggling. Tempest is definitely struggling, only at 180 gold per minute, so that could definitely play a role here as the game picks up, of course. But we'll keep an eye on that and see how that progresses. Warbeast at the top lane in the meantime. Forsaken Archer is going to apply some good damage on him and kind of really box him out of the lane. Forsaken is the top farmer in the game. Not too surprising to see that there. Back to Forsaken, though. I mean, this is a hero, again, not a carry option we see too often. What kind of build do you expect to see on Forsaken Archer this game?
Most commonly, you'll see them go for Frostburn or just straight-up Geos early on, even Shrunken Head really early on. You get a decent amount of damage from your ulti and your skeletons, so damage isn't really a problem.
Yeah.
Just survivability. And then late game, I wouldn't be surprised if we saw a Wingbow. Usually they go for lifesteal, but it's really up to their call and how they feel the game is progressing. Mm-hmm. So.
Middle lane, there was actually a very close kill on a Zephyr, but Demented Shaman and Insania doing a great job keeping him alive. You do see his build, he's not going in Tangle whatsoever. He's just going max defense here with the heal wave on top of the Unbreakable. And that's kind of interesting, you know, there always is that interesting thing with the Demented Shaman. If you're going to go the Entangle, you usually at least need to get at least level 3 of it. Bottom lane, though, in the meantime, actually, Pharaoh's going to wrath the Pharaoh right there. He's trying to survive. The Kelfin initially locking him down. Can he get away? No, he cannot. The final auto attack. And Panny will get credit for the Bloodlust kill, a very much needed Bloodlust kill in for Tempest right there, as again, he has been somewhat struggling in that jungle. So that'll boost his GPM up, and that's a big start here for Team NK. So good gank on a Pharaoh at the bottom lane right there.
Yeah, and with that, we'll probably want to start pushing the tower soon. Although Fire does have a little bit of counter push, it just gives Bubbles and Tempest a little bit more of a lead. Mm-hmm. So that they have the level advantage and the gold advantage, so they can pressure a little bit more.
This Zephyr, I think, has almost died like three different times right now, but Demented Shaman just barely getting there in time to keep him alive yet again, so... That's got to be really frustrating for this Pebbles Engineer combination, because, you know, if you're this combo right here, Pebbles, he's not doing the best. He's only 21-2 compared to that 36-4 Zephyr right now. You know, he would have really liked at least one of those kills, but once again, obviously not actually happening. So that's got to be pretty frustrating for him, but more so even for Team NK, you know, Zephyr kind of having a good time with that. But this Pebbles slow start, how big of a deal is this going to be for... For recent gaming, you think?
I actually think it's a big deal. Pebbles a while back was really strong and it didn't really matter. Once he got his portal key, he kind of just snowballed. But now that his combo is weaker, and especially against this kind of tanky team coming out from NK, like Zephyr is really not going to be able to get picked off by Pebbles, so he doesn't need to worry about that. And if Tempest builds really tanky, he survives as well.
Yeah.
So Pebbles really needs to catch back up and get a lot of pickoffs.
Well, that's not going to help things right there. Pebbles obviously dying in the middle lane. Top lane also. That was a beautiful response, by the way, coming out by Imba Boy specifically. Doing a great turnaround out of Bubbles right there, using his crippling volley to help him do so. And the piercing arrows and getting the kill on top of the tower, going back to the middle lane. Engineer also falls. So kind of a lot of back and forth going on. I mean, that's kind of interesting because it's hard. I don't know. Could you really say either side coming out on top there? Because... Both sides getting their carry presence heroes some great farm right there as a result of what just happened. Forsaken Archer, though, he just boosts over 400 GPM now as a result of that. So you think either side coming out on top there?
Not sure. I'm still not in the game. I'm trying to cast from outside.
Wait a sec, you're not in the game?
No. What is casting from outside.
What the fuck is going on? Why didn't you tell me this? You actually can't join the game?
Yeah, I'm trying to message other people.
Oh my gosh, what is going on? So wait, you can't actually...
I have it, but it's just not working. The monkey head.
Interesting. Well, that kind of explains some things. I'm sitting here... Oh man, that makes things a little more difficult. I can understand.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's actually really funny, though. Okay, yeah. I mean, so you tried restarting Han and whatnot.
I've relogged, restarted the client, done it all.
Turn off any of these players. That is really weird. Really weird. Well, we'll keep going for this one, I guess, and try to make it as good as possible. We'll see if we can maybe get it fixed after this first game, obviously. But Warby's at the top lane. He's actually gonna run away before he actually gets killed right there. Oh, Engineer trying to cut him off, but it's not gonna happen. And Warbeast will be fine when it's all said and done. But gonna be able to escape, but Forsaken Archer though. Okay, so I guess so. As far as that exchange, but yeah, I think it was pretty even from what I could tell between the two teams. I mean, Forsaken Archer again, his farm is definitely going up, but now that you see the push starting to happen from Team NK, they push in the bottom tower. Bubbles and Tempest coming together right there, and they take out that bottom tower. You see in the middle lane, Zephyr. Obviously, he's continuing to have a good time. He's now at 380 gold per minute. Doing very strong there. And Bubbles is actually just going to keep things going at this bottom side. So, in the meantime, Tempest rotating over. Actually, we're going to cut off Engineer for picking up a refreshment room. May end up getting a kill with this. They're definitely going to get a kill. Tila did not really stand a chance right there. He just ran into too many enemies at the same time. So, good pickoff coming out from Team NK. And now, all of a sudden, we're looking at a 4-2 hero kill advantage in their favor over recent gaming. So this golden experience lead, and now again they're grouping up. The middle lane push is going to be happening right here as they're working out to take in the middle tower. I don't think recent gaming is going to do much of anything to stop this. Doesn't look like it. So yeah, that's going to be an easy tower kill. Zephyr, and actually pulls in Pebbles right here. The Typhoon comes out. Bubbles in the meantime. Shells are coming out. Kelfin on top of that. And Pebbles is not going to live. He just stands knowing that he's dead basically. and yet another kill. So again, you see this momentum really starting to pick up now for Team NK. That's definitely what a lineup like this can make happen, especially with the hands of Zephyr. You know, you got the Tempest versus to push. Warby's doing great things. It's all starting to come together pretty well for the team. So it's safe to say definitely a shining hope here for the Hellborn side. Is no doubt Imba Boy on Forsaken Archer, as he has the Steam Boots, he has the Energizer, and the Ring of the Teacher. So, but yeah, I know it could definitely be difficult to cast outside of the game. So I don't know if you may be able to pick up on anything here. I'll just try my best to maybe ask some questions that come up. Here as we start in the game, bud.
I'm trying, but yeah, definitely, as you said, that momentum just really kicks in. A couple hero pickoffs, and they can just take towers with ease. Just it goes with how strong their team is. Warby's push is really amazing, as well as Zephyr and Demented, and on top of that, you have Tempest.
Yeah.
And then you have Bubbles for the team fight, so good draft. As we're seeing it come out, it's really working out for them, and they're playing to their advantages, having that early game aggression against kind of a late game passive team.
12 minutes in, though, actually, Recent Gaming is going to counter push the middle tower. So they do a good job right there. I mean, Typhoon was down, so maybe taking a little bit of advantage there of a bigger cooldown being down. But with that said, Tempest Ultimate and Kelfield are still good to go. And Typhoon's going to be up in 20 seconds. But actually, Pebbles, oh, he's playing sneaky. He has an ancient spell. He's going to jump Demented Shaman. And Demented Shaman just melts to the ground. Energy Field going to be casting as well. And now Haxorn ends up trouble. He's going to kind of kite things around, trying to take as little damage as possible. But when all five heroes are collapsing on top of you, it is too difficult to avoid death, so he will get taken out as well. And the movement from Recent Gaming, just like we're talking about Team NK kind of starting to group it up and picking up momentum, Recent Gaming now picking up momentum. They're starting to get take advantage of their gank aggression here, and they're actually getting some nice picks coming out. So, yeah, you know, it's kind of interesting. It looked like Team NK was getting some big things going for them, but now all of a sudden, we have a case where Recent Gaming, the golden experience is practically identical at this point. And they're actually going to be pushing a secondary tower right here. So this is going to be even more gold for them. However, we do see the top lane now. Pebbles is in some trouble. Warby said Tempest collapsing together. Pebbles trying to hold his ground. He does have TP coming in, but cannot survive long enough. And Panny actually picking up credit for the kill right there. So we do see 13 and a half minutes in right now. It is a good kill for Team NK coming out. As, Ninja is actually joining the game, so looks like at least that part of it is working. Uh-oh, but Warby's actually at the top lane, gonna be locked down. He cannot get out of this. Root coming out. The piercing arrows, he dodges as much damage as possible, but he will fall. And that will be the end of that. All right, it looks like you're joining, Diglett.
So finally
things,
in.
So things aren't as awkward anymore. Thank
you. Yeah.
You're actually able to see information now, which definitely helps things out. All right, so I know you haven't been able to witness what's been going on yet, but hopefully, you know, from the cast alone, you've been picking up on a lot of things. Now that you can actually start seeing some things here. Here we are, 14 minutes in. It's 6-6 hero kill game. It's, but top lane, this action, I mean, it's actually not stopping, it seems like. Bubble's going to catch Keeper of the Force right here with the Kelfield, and Zephyr will help finish him off. Pebbles and Pharaoh actually will fall back before they can do anything about it, so... Man, Diglett, this has actually been a pretty aggressive game all of a sudden once the momentum started going. So now that you're joining in, I mean, what do you think about how the game looks like to you?
It looks pretty much what I expected it to be. I just caught that last glimpse of Bubbles, and he actually hid on the side so that the ward from Reason Gaming didn't see him. So he shelled behind them, from behind them, and just ulted in. Really great initiation.
Yeah.
But again, Pebbles doesn't have much, and as you can see, it's kind of hard for him to snowball back. He kind of needs the PK to be a little bit more useful, because his combo isn't strong enough by itself.
Yeah.
And NK looking to push top. Tempest picking up that Astrolabe, again, just making him more tanky and more of that early game aggression.
Yeah, the group up here obviously going to be... pretty hard to stop at this tower. I don't think we're going to see a hold here by any means coming out from Recent Gaming. Yeah, the cooldowns and Keeper of the Force being dead, and they're not in that position. So this, yeah, should be a free tower kill. You mentioned that lack of Portakey on Pebbles. It is struggling. 500 gold only saved up. Probably going to be coming next in line, but we'll definitely be a little bit before we see that. Zephyr off to the side. He's going to pick up some jungle creeps while the rest of his team actually picks off the tower as expected. So some good teamwork going to be coming out right there. We will get an answer here in the near future as far as what Forsaken Archer is going to be going for. Again, the Steam Boots, the Energizer, as you're talking about. It's going to be interesting, you know, eventually maybe getting that Whispering Home for the Lifesteal. But we see the Firebrand into Geometers being here. It'll be up to Imbaboy to decide. Now, the secondary tower is a different thing, though. They're still going. Can Reason stop this?
It looks like they want to try. But I'd say they have to be really careful. Because Tempest does have his hole.
Yeah.
And they kind of have everything up.
Yeah, there's no Keeper of the Forest. Oh, there is Keeper of the Forest. I thought I was like, still on cooldown, but they do have that, so. Yeah, we got a fight going right here. Bubbles jumps in. Nice stalagmites in the background, though, to kind of cut them off. Kelfu going to be used on four heroes. Warbeast on the front lines. He's being locked down. The root comes out. He's going to be locked down the whole time. Piercing arrows doing plenty of damage. Bubbles will fall right there as well. And so far, it's a 2-for-nothing exchange in favor of Reason Gaming. But Hax wants some kills, but now he needs to run. The piercing arrow, the crippling ball that hits Tempest. Tempest will be picked off. He could not find an opportunity for an ultimate. And now Zephyr's going to be locked down. The mummy walls are out. He's going to be eventually bursted down. Everyone alive for Reason Gaming. I was on the boat with you, Diggly. I didn't know it was going to be a risky hold. Hell, they made it an unbelievable hold. A 4-for-nothing isn't going to be a genocide. Demented Shaman's just trying to live, damn it. Can he actually survive? I think he just may. But, oh, whoa, God. Oh, no. Oh, that stutter. Might have made the difference. Oh, get just out of range. There's the nuke, the auto attack. Oh, my God, what's going on? Oh, Bubbles jumps in. He'll pick up Keeper at one cost. A double tap for Tank Effect. So, kind of a fun end there. But I think it's safe to say, though, the big picture, Reason Gaming, damn good hold coming out from them.
Yeah, that was really well played. They got, I don't know if it was to say lucky, if they kind of planned it that way. But Power Warbeast, like, when he tried to run out of the NG field, he walked right into Pharaoh Mummies and got pushed back into the NG field. So that was kind of rough for him, and he got completely locked down with the Keeper Root.
Yeah.
So once they took him out, they then just took out Bubbles as well with the Keeper Root and the NG field. And then they kind of just picked the rest of the team off by having the advantage.
Yeah.
So really well done by them. But yeah, that was surprising.
Talk about a huge counter to Warbeast. I mean, especially before that Shrunken Head. The Root is just so good against a hero like that. And that was definitely a big far degree there, so... a great, great hold definitely coming out for Reason Gaming, so they are going to work off of that. The Shrunken Head first item, actually, for Forsaken. Bottom lane, though, Dimension Shaman, he's in trouble. He's going to get pushed. He's right on the energy field. He got blocked in by the turret. That was just beautiful play, honestly, from Tilla right there. Coming out, a little bit of assistance from Zane, but mainly Tilla to get the kill on the solo Dimension Shaman. But first item, Shrunken Head. What are your thoughts on that? I mean, this is a pretty magic-heavy team on the Legion side, so...
Yeah, with all that magic, I mean, they do have a little bit of physical with Warbeast and Demented's Heal Bomb. Mm-hmm. But for the most part, they're magic. And with Shrunken Head, they don't really have any lockdown besides for Tempest Toll. So as long as he doesn't get ulted, he should be okay to just sit in the back and just destroy the team, really.
Yeah. So the push will continue here in favor of Reason Gaming. And so now it's kind of their turn, I guess. No, they're not going to go for this. Forsaken Archer's on the top lane, so yeah, not going to risk pushing without him. And also, they want to defend up here, it looks like, because look at what Warbeast is leading the way. And meanwhile, the teammates are actually kind of nearby. You got Tempest, Zephyr, and Bubbles all in the vicinity, but doesn't look like anything's going to happen as a result. Instead, they'll start falling back. And that'll be the end of the push attempts right there. So, Zephyr, though, 3,300 gold. I mean... is this going to be a right-click Shrunken, do you think? What are we going to see on Zephyr?
Honestly, no clue. There's kind of any direction he can take with it. I think he's waiting for the other team to get an item. I think if they get a bunch of portal keys, he may end up going towards a Mach, maybe. But I think Shrunken would be a good choice, if not just going straight tanky. Getting that Frostburn or Dawnbringer into like a Heart or just a Bulwark and just tank up.
Alright, I mean, okay, yeah. Right click of the Shrunken, yeah, that's... speaking of that, Forsaken Archer actually gets it pretty much at the same time. Hell, their GPMs are basically identical, so not too surprising to see them both pick up that item at the exact same time. We'll see how that works out. Uh-oh, but Warbeast. Warbeast is going to wish he had a Shrunken Head here in the near future. Pebbles, he's going to get a perfect jump from the infants. There's the lockdown from Forsaken Archer. The piercing arrows, the chuck in the air. Very good patience coming out. And... down goes Zibbe, so Yeah, he did not stand a chance, and Warbeast is being locked down pretty well this game by Reason Gaming. They're going to group up and push top now. It's actually now Zephyr might be in a little bit of trouble. No, not enough team support, so falling back beforehand. But Reason Gaming, I mean, this should be a free tower kill here, you think. Yeah, it's going to easily be one.
It doesn't look like NK wants to defend, and they would just want to counter push instead. DS can kind of push bottom while they push middle. But Reason Gaming is definitely coming to defend both towers, actually. So, yeah.
Is that a portal key on Pebbles? It is.
Yep.
And 1900 gold saved up, so he's actually had that for a little bit. Wow, for some reason that didn't hit me until just right now. But he's actually going to pick up a Warhammer here on top of the portal key. What about, speaking of portal key, that's actually a quick play picked up by Forsaken, so getting that, at least the Firebrand next in line most likely. Keeper of the Forest, he has 2200 golds now saved up. Do you think they need a portal key on him as well?
I think they're safe on initiation. Between having Pharaoh and Pebbles that now has a portal key, I think he's probably just going to go for a Resto stun. It's probably safer. And in case Zephyr ever does get a mock, portal key wouldn't really be the best option for Keeper. And so far he's been landing pretty decent ultis, so yep. I don't think he feels he needs it.
Alright, so they might need to come into play soon as they are kind of grouping up again. This time at the bottom lane is Reason Gaming. And they're going to make a push happen down here. Imba Boy, he is 3-0-5. And I'll tell you what, I mean, when it comes to hero kill stats, I know it's only stats like that only mean so much. You can definitely take something from it. Imba Boy seems like he's that. The hero kill stats are pretty damn good always. I mean, as far as very little deaths and a lot of kills and assists for his team. So he seems like he's pretty good at that whole staying alive part when it comes to the carry role, which, as you know yourself, Diglett, is, of course, very important. Staying
yep.
alive.
I'd be surprised if Reason didn't keep going right here at bottom. They have a lot more room to work with because NK is not at their tower yet. And, they're back. Never mind. But yeah, going back to Imba Boy, as far as Reason draft goes and how they play, they protect him a lot. They usually put him in the short lane, if not in like a pseudo tri lane. So he always does well. He has pretty consistent scores as far as hero kills and farm alone. Mm-hmm. So he's a pretty solid player and he knows what he's doing. So.
Yeah, he certainly does. And in fact, a Firebrand going to be delivered to him right here. So has that finished? Now, again, the question of will we see now into that Geometer's Bane or will it even be something like a Frostbird into the eventual Dawnbringer perhaps? But only time will tell. Imba Boy, I'm guessing you would prefer the Geometer's Bane here.
Yeah, I prefer Geos on a lot of ranged heroes, just because the escape is really nice, especially against Tempest. Because if Tempest stuns FA, you can just Geos out of it and then Shrunken right away, and it's pretty safe. And I don't like going Dawnbringer if I have the intent of going a Geometer's. So even if he doesn't go the Geos now, if he goes for the Frostburn and eventually in the Frostwolf Skull, I would just keep it at the Frostburn and then eventually break it.
Forsaken, actually level 15 now. He's actually gonna. He's playing a little bit of a advanced place right here, but that's because they're gonna try to cut them off. Warbeast, he gets initiated out by Feral, and then Packard is trying to run away with the ulti form. It will be enough to Kelfield, just buying enough time, if anything, to keep them alive. So, good gank attempt coming out from Reason. They will clean off the remaining Ancients that were here, at least, and fall back to continue to farm. So, good kind of cutoff there. Not no casualties happening, so in the end, definitely in their favor. And talked about the Restoration Stone, just saw the Sustainer purchased by Keeper of the Forest, and actually, was it an Arcana as well? I think it might have been, so I think he might just need the pattern, honestly, at this point, and then he'll be good to go with a full Resto Stone here, so St. Rock's moving along very nicely for his team. As far as, more action perhaps, Pharaoh running into Haxorin, I don't know if he can get close enough. He doesn't have the Wrath of Pharaoh for 7 more seconds. And so it doesn't look like an engineer, though, actually places a very aggressive ward to sight right there. And then falls back. So barbed armor, by the way, on a hero like Pharaoh. Not only is that a typical item pickup on him, but it is great against heroes like Zephyr. So I'm sure you'd like to see that pickup there.
Yeah. If he hooks Zephyr or Warbeast and then pops barbed armor, they kind of just have to sit there or try to attack the mummies and get out. But they're usually stunned. So getting that kind of just guarantees a few seconds of lockdown, if not a ton of damage on Warbeast or Zephyr if they're not paying attention. And if Zephyr doesn't have his shrunken head up, his Cyclones will pretty much eat him alive.
Yeah. So. That could be dangerous. Kongor going to be... It's still the Yeti, by the way. Still the Yeti Kongor coming out here. But no, Yeti Kongor going to be attempted right here. And it's by attempted, it's going to be an easy kill in the end. I mean, recent gaming, no contention whatsoever from Team NK. And, I mean, there is no vision, so I really wonder if this is just simply a case of Team NK was not observant enough to realize that Kongor was going on. Because, I don't know, I kind of feel like they could definitely try to contest with that, but... They chose not to. I mean, what do you? If they knew about it, do you think they should have tried?
I think it's kind of a hard call. I think they should have tried it, especially since Tempest bought his items. He bought the Mighty Blade. Like, he wasn't saving for a portal key or anything, and nobody is really close to a big item. Mm-hmm. So it's not like they would have lost much. But I think they definitely should have tried to fight it, or at least tried to, like, steal the token with bubbles or try something.
Poke in there. Yeah.
Because they kind of just conceded it. And they did have vision.
Did they?
A little bit of vision, because Engineer countered the ward. So they should have known between that, and then they can scout with Warbeast Wolves.
Scout with them Wolves! Very important lesson that we all know about on the competitive scene. Not contesting it at all, and actually Forsaken Archer, he goes right, he picks up the Token of Life, and interesting pickup from him on top of that, Pebbles actually might be in some trouble. He's going to have to Shrunken Head, he's going to go for the TP, yes, it'll be just enough right there. Oh, that is pretty huge, because they were all collapsing on top of him to pick up a kill, as Warbeast actually charges in right here, he runs right into a Death Trap, he's in ulti for himself, but he's not going to be able to make it out of there. Not too sure what Warbeast was thinking. In the meantime, Pharaoh cuts off Demented Shaman, and that's going to be another easy kill on top of that, as Pharaoh just kind of sits there and lets Demented Shaman die right in front of him. So, that went from getting a jump on a Pebbles to all of a sudden two deaths on Team NK. And I was also going to mention, Forsaken Archer, how about this greedy build? He goes Shieldbreaker. I mean, I wonder if maybe that has a little bit to do with him just getting the Token of Life, but going the Shieldbreaker, Diglett.
Yeah, it's kind of risky and a little bit greedy. But they are ahead, so they can do that. And it's not, like, the worst pickup. I think it's pretty strong, especially because they have so much armor between Demented and Zephyr. Mm-hmm. So it's a pretty solid pickup.
Yeah, did everyone lag for you right there?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that was the server. Yeah, you see everyone is actually in the well right here. So. I think the server had a little bit of a hiccup, unfortunately, so everyone's like back in the well at this point. And so a little bit of a minor hiccup there, unfortunately, so I'm going to go ahead and give a pause, of course, and hopefully resume and nothing more than that. So, but yeah, you could tell it's like it was more than just us that was affected by that. But Forsaken Archer, I mean, he has enough to even upgrade it to level 2. We'll see if he actually does that here. But I'm sure I'm going to go all the way to level 3. And yeah, with that split fire, it definitely helps make it an item, as you're talking about with Shieldbreaker, you know, that much more important or that much more powerful even in the hands of him. So it's going to be fun to see that coming into play. And yeah, the No Souls Bulwark on the Legion side. I mean, especially now with that pickup coming out, Souls Bulwark, it's tough because, I mean, who would you get it on? Because, yes, Zephyr and Warbeast are two great candidates, but you would think Warbeast really wants that Shrunken Head ASAP. And Zephyr's, you know, he's building into a... He has a Firebrand he wants to build off of that. Do they need that Soul's Bulwark, or can they just continue progressing normally?
I feel like they should be getting the Souls. I feel like Warbeast should be able to get it, but again, he needs the Shrunken. And he's kind of pretty far behind. He's 0-4, and he hasn't really... He has okay farm. Yeah. Not the greatest for a Warbeast, and they kind of have... A lot of farm to split between Tempest and Zephyr, and Bubbles is even taking some to get in that semi-carry role. Mm-hmm. So, and even Demented has a fair amount of creep kills.
Yeah.
So.
That's true.
Seeing it on a Warbeast is a little bit better because getting that Demonic is a little bit stronger on Warbeast than it is on Zephyr. Mm-hmm.
We're going to try to come out of the pause here. Hopefully, again, everything should be good to go. just a little bit of a hiccup within the server. It happens. Yep. Progression here for Zephyr. Again, the Firebrand You think it is going to be that full Dawnbringer, or Geometor's Bane, kind of like the same thing with Forsaken?
I feel like in this case, he should be going for the Geos. Since Keeper has had the same items for quite a while, he should be knowing that he's going for the Resto Stone. So going for the Geo Shrunken allows him to get out of both routes, and I feel like that's the route he's headed for.
Yeah.
Or at least he should be headed for. But Dawnbringer is okay, but again, Geos is a lot better.
Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense. And I'm pretty sure St. Rock's just needs the pattern. I'm pretty sure I've seen him buy both the Arcana. Yeah, with his 365 GPM, that must be the case. So he needs the, I think it's 1875, if I'm not mistaken, for the pattern. And then, yep, 1875, and then he'll be good to go for that. So that's definitely just around the corner. So getting that Geometer's Bane, even that much more important. Panning on Tempest, you know, he unfortunately hasn't really had the opportunity to use that ultimate just yet. This game, as we're approaching 28 minutes in, so again, we'll see if that eventually comes a kid, but it's only going to get harder. I mean, you not only will now have a double root to deal with, but a Pharaoh on top of that, that could stop it if need be. So, oh yeah, it looks like there might still be a little bit of some hiccups going on. I guess ping all doesn't really do much in a pause, so I can't really check that, but the ABC test. Classic ABC test. All right, well, since this is some downtown, like I was talking about earlier, if we ever got some. Interesting news, actually, on the competitive forums. Actually, so I mentioned earlier today, State Green, of course, they played Denali Esports. They beat them 2-0 to move on to the next round. Shortly after that match happened, Zlapped, the captain of Denali Esports, he actually made a post in the competitive forums announcing that Mickey is no longer competitive Han. He's no longer part of the team. So for those that, you know, are interested, Mickey is apparently no longer part of Denali Esports and is going to be stopping to play competitive Han for now, I guess. You know, just simply wasn't really feeling it as of late, and so going to be moving on. So best of luck to him with whatever his future holds, but it definitely is a sad day. Mickey's a great player and fun guy. I got to meet him at Atlanta. I'm sure you got to meet him too, right?
I didn't really hang out with him. I saw him a lot, and I've heard a lot that he's a cool guy. It's always sad to see Han players go. But, you know, some people just lose the spark, you know? They stop enjoying the game. And
it happens. It happens. But that also, you know, it definitely brings up another interesting point of who's going to be the new fifth now for Denali Esports. Because that's what they've been a five-man team. They haven't really been known to have a sixth man. So, that's going to be interesting to see who eventually ends up in that new fifth spot, of course. And, you know, especially on top of that, with only one more cycle remaining, again, they just got knocked out. So they have cycle number 10. And we announced yesterday on the podcast the playoff format, actually, for Han Tourist Season 2 and how that's going to be shaping up and how that's looking. So, again, and these seeds are very important. The higher seed you get, the lot more benefits you get in that playoff stage to eventually get the chance to make the Global Grand Finals. So Denali Esports is only going to have a very short time to try to get a quick replacement in there and have a strong finish within cycle number 10. So that's definitely going to be interesting to see how that of course shapes up. So obviously we'll give this another minute here. If it doesn't look like anything's going to be happening, then we'll probably actually, you know what we should just do at this point. Let's just go ahead and take a break ourselves as well. Get some music going on, since, you know, just sitting staring at a solid or a pause screen isn't the most entertaining. So we're gonna take a short break here, ladies and gentlemen. Definitely sit tight, though. Give you guys updated on what the deal is and what's gonna be happening here. So obviously here we are, game number one, Reason Gaming taking on Team NK. Break CBK joined by Diglett here on HanCast. We got Han Tour Season 2, Cycle 9, Loser's Bracket Round 4 matchup. Game number one. Definitely stay tuned, guys. We'll be back after a short break. I'm sure I'll keep you guys updated. Stay tuned.
I'm running out.
All right. It looks like we're back now. So the server, I believe it was several servers, actually. It wasn't just this specific server. Anyways, we're having some issues right there. Definitely some hiccups, but seems like things are good to go now. A little bit unfortunate because the recent gaming, because of the server issue, they did lose a little bit of token time. On the token of life, they're actually down to 2.5 minutes right now. So, when I believe it was around 5 minutes or so beforehand, so a little bit unfortunate there. But to say the least, Reason Gaming is definitely still in a pretty good spot, and they are in the lead here on 30.5 minutes in. So, once again, I'm joined by Diglett here. I believe he's still here.
I'm still here.
You're still here. Good. He didn't lag out. Good.
I thought I did, but the server was just being crazy, and. Recent Gaming lost a tower.
Yeah, that did happen too. That's true. Yeah, it's unfortunate, but I mean, what are we gonna do? I mean, you don't really have many options at this point. Technical issues happen, and you know, I don't think at the same time, I don't think Recent Gaming would necessarily want to just straight up remake either. I mean, they are in the lead, so let's just continue on with this game as they are doing. So, anyways, here we are. They're gonna be pushing the middle lane. It looks like as Forsaken Archer is going to be leading the way. Forsaken's level 18, by the way. Jeez. He really is getting some good farm going on. And something's being delivered. It is another Shieldbreaker, and the Resto Stone is finished for Keeper of the Forest. So, Reason Gaming, I mean, you got a decent lead here. Do you got the Token of Life. They're gonna look to push your Diglett.
Yeah. I think they should be trying to push the side lanes. Side lanes are much easier than just going straight up mid. Especially because Keeper doesn't have a portal key, so him kind of maneuvering in the middle is going to be difficult. But they definitely need to push. They had two big pickups. They still have the token, so.
So they're going to, speaking of that token, it is down to 40 seconds now. So they really only have one more creep wave right here of actually having that token alive. As there we go, the pebbles. Oh, he missed the jump on the hero. Deathgrowl's in now in a lot of trouble. He's going to be forced to Shrieker Knight and run away. Zep, for the meantime, taking some good auto attacks there. But no one dying when it's all said and done. Forsaken Archer basically at a point of saying, kill me. You don't want to be too overzealous with that, though. And it looks like they are just ultimately going to fall back when it's all said and done. So, again, a little bit unfortunate. Weren't able to use the Token of Life as much as they wanted to. But in the end, they keep Team NK in their base, and they're going to kind of clean up their resources. So, you know, overall, still not the worst thing in the world for the Hellborn team by any means. I think you would agree there.
Yeah. Now they can kind of just sit back and keep NK in their base. A little bit and just keep dewarding with the eye and just keep pressure so that they can't really get the farm and then just out resource control them. Keep getting the farm. Even Pharaoh now has a shrunken head. So
he
they're
does.
All kind of getting big.
Yeah, they definitely are adding up those items. A level 3 Shieldbreaker, of course, on Forsaken Archer. Can assume that perhaps that Geometer's Bane going to be next in line for him as we're talking about. Speaking of Soul's Bulwark, Pebbles is actually maybe getting close to one. He's just about 2,000 gold saved up, so kind of curious to see if that is possibly his item choice or not. Geometer's Bane is finished on Haxorin, so we were talking about that and how going up against this Restill Stone, Keeper of the Forest, of course, very important to have, so he does have two ways now to be able to get out of it. Shrunken Head finished on Warbeast. Again, this kind of goes back to that idea. They still don't have a Soul's Bulwark on this Legion team, so now we'll possibly see Warbeast look to pick one up. But he did want to finish that Shrunken Head as soon as possible and understandably. I feel like there's constantly Invis runes on this Hellborn team, by the way. Pharaoh now has one as he's trying to scout things out, but don't know if that's going to be happening. Okay, if you're Tempest here, you know, you're going up against the rest of Stone Keeper, you're going up against a Pharaoh even. Do you go for that full Resto Stone next yourself? Do you just get a portal key and kind of go for that all-in jump? What do you do here?
I don't know. They're pretty far behind now, so I wouldn't be surprised if they kind of just went for the portal key for the all-in jump, try to get all five to come back, because that's kind of what they need. They need to really, really crush a team fight to get back in this game. They're still in it. They still have good team fight potential, and if Tempest does hold them, that'll allow them to get back in the game. But it's going to be really rough for him, without a portal key especially.
Yeah. Definitely need a Big, big play to happen from Panty. And again, he has, I don't even think he's attempted an ultimate yet. It's just been that kind of game. He hasn't actually found the opportunity to use it yet. Now here we are 35 minutes into the game. And I mean, he's had a solid game. He's 3-1-0, 290 goal per minute. But again, just hasn't had the opportunity. So in the meantime, Imbo Poi on Forsaken Archer. He's just going to continue to play the farm game. Is there a little bit of a time limit, though, you think, almost for this Hellborn team? Because the Zephyr could definitely scale for decently, but especially the Warbeast. He's the one that you might want to be a little bit more worried about as far as the game really starts to pick up. Do you think Recent Gaming needs to kind of make a point to push in here sooner than later?
Yeah, they kind of do. FA does have a timer, but so does Zephyr. Just because Zephyr's, you know, he has Helm of the Black Legion and Vestments, and he needs to have the Shrunken Head and Geo. So four of his slots are filled up, pretty much. Mm-hmm. I mean, he could trade out the Helm, but then he's not so tanky anymore. Mm-hmm. So he has a timer as well, so I'd say they're pretty even. Again, they do need to look out for that Warbeast, but he's not having that great of a farm. So it's not that big of a deal. I hope he goes for the Bulwark soon, just because Pebbles has his as well. So all of that negative armor, they're going to need a little bit more to stay alive.
Yeah. All right, apparently some hiccups once again. I don't think it's as dramatic as the other ones that we had that with the pauses for a good 15 minutes here. So hopefully short to resume and then again cross the fingers and at least be able to make it through this game number one here without too much else. Because again, in the end, you know, every party, us, the viewers, the players, I mean, we just want this game to be played in the end and not have these technical issues, but our ultimate out of our control to an extent, so gotta just kind of pray to the Han gods that it does get fixed up. Again, the Geometer's Bane for Forsaken. Is that being delivered, actually? Yeah, it is. So, has that good to go. They are kind of making the way. Both teams kind of in the vicinity of going towards the top lane right here. So, we'll see if they maybe run into each other or not. The thing is, Pharaoh and an Engineer aren't actually up at the top lane. So this could definitely work out for Team NK if they perhaps catch Recent Gaming a little bit off guard up here at this top side. Probably not going to be happening, but the Hellhound's going to scout things out. So, yeah, they're going to make their way over. And I don't think the Hellborn team has any vision of this area. But, no, they're not going to be able to get it. Bubbles does have a portal key. Just can't really find the angle, though. Maybe in the middle lane they may find it. Pharaoh could be that target. Oh, especially for Forsaken Archer. There's the Kelfield. Going to catch him. He does have a Shrunken and a Geos, though. Using the Geos right there. Gets cuts back in. It forces him to Shrunken at least. And that will be the end of that. So they did get the Shrunken Head to be used at least. And, you know, so taking a second off of that. It's a small victory there for Team NK. Yep. Congress back up, by the way.
Yep. And now that Bubbles, Kelp is down. Hellborn may want to try that, but again, they don't have the FA Shrunken, so both teams are probably going to wait for those to come back up, I would imagine, for them to start it, at least attempt it. But if NK gives up Kong again, it's going to be a very grim game for them.
Yeah. That's definitely could be a difficult time. So, we'll see if, I mean, you can tell the Hellborn team right now, they got the Bound Die over here. They're scouting some things out. They're kind of setting themselves up for another Conqueror kill, and here we go. Forsaken Archer going to lead the way. Pharaoh obviously going in with the Hellfire. Very good against doing tanking that Conqueror. And their Team NK is going to head on over. As apparently, oh god, they have zero pauses. So this is the grind it out game, unfortunately. And have to deal with it. So they are going to go into the Yeti Conqueror right here. And it's going to be a Conqueror kill. I mean, Team NK, they just cannot get over here in time. Haxor is just going to farm away in the jungle, and so that goes back to what you were just talking about. Another Conqueror kill could really hurt Team NK here. And that's exactly what just happened. Pebbles in the meantime, he jumps Demented Shaman. Insania is probably going to be picked out for Hero. Breakable goes up, though, keeping him alive just barely. The team support is there. The Shrunken goes off. Finally, they take out Demented Shaman, put it one cost right here. Tempest gets locked down. The energy field is way too much. He could not get the ulti off. Did not even have a chance to Shrunken Head right there. And the Legion team is falling apart. Warbeast goes down. Zephyr's now in trouble. He's going to eventually fall. And it's going to be a 5-0. A genocide. And there you go. GG, well played. You know, call it what you will, but Recent Gaming, they take the victory when it's all said and done. So, yeah, server issues. I mean, in the end, both teams did have to deal with it. But Recent Gaming did have the lead for pretty much that whole game as it progressed on. So, final thoughts on that game number one there, Diglett?
Outside of server issues, I think Recent Gaming played it well. NK definitely should not have given up both Congors. I think they should have at least tried to contest, or at least tried to steal. Because they had vision of at least one, or if not both, or they should have known at least. So, but well played to both teams. It's nice to see heroes that aren't really played that often played, as far as Pharaoh and FA. So kudos to Reason for making old heroes.